This could be the most important video you've watched in a long time. I'm gonna teach you what computer experts do not want you to know. Well, actually it's the exact opposite. They probably really wish you would know all these things because it would make their lives easier doing tech support. Basically, this video is gonna teach you the art of how to fix any computer problem, even if you have no idea how, and even if you are not a computer person. And I do urge you to stick around because the stuff I'm gonna teach you will be incredibly useful literally for the rest of your life. The first thing, which is really important to understand, is computer experts and tech support techie people are not wizards and they don't know everything. We simply Google search anything we don't know how to fix, which is honestly most things. However, I would argue that what makes someone a good computer problem solver is really down to knowing what to search for. To someone who's a computer expert, this type of skill is pretty intuitive. And yes, I would consider Google searching a skill, and we'll get into why, and you'll probably see there's a little bit more to it. They might not even be able to articulate their process of finding these solutions, but I will. That's what this video is about. I'll do my best to lay it all out step by step. Before we get into that though, I want to talk about today's sponsor, Bitdefender, and specifically their product, Bitdefender Total Security. More than just an antivirus, it's a complete security suite covering all major platforms, namely Windows, Mac, iOS, and Android. It's highly rated by independent labs and won Product of the Year from AV Comparatives in 2019 and won Best Protection and Best Performance from AV Test. It has a wide array of features such as network threat prevention, which can stop attacks before they begin by blocking malicious attempts on system vulnerabilities and brute force attacks. Plus, it has anti-phishing web protection, which will warn you when you come across fraudulent pages. In my opinion, this type of real-time protection is key because it can protect you against attacks that are not your fault and happen in the background, or so-called drive-by attacks. It also has multi-layer ransomware protection, including ransomware remediation, which basically instantly backs up any files it detects is trying to be encrypted by ransomware and restores it after that malware is blocked. Plus, there's plenty of other features such as webcam protection and microphone usage notifications from untrusted apps, as well as performance profiles that detects when you're playing a game, watching a movie, or doing work, and automatically adjusts background tasks and pop-ups so you aren't disturbed. Be sure to check out the link in the description where you can get a special extended 120-day free trial for new users, 4 months, which covers up to 5 of your devices. That's way longer than the usual 30-day trial, which is awesome. And with all that being said though, let's continue. So, getting into the meat and bones. Anytime you have a computer problem, software problem, your device is acting weird, no matter what electronic it is, the first thing you should try every time, no matter what kind of computer tech problem you're having, is to simply turn the thing off and on again. This will fix the problem 90% of the time. It does not matter what the device is, whether it's a TV, computer, or phone. Also, if necessary, you can try turning it off and then unplugging the thing too. Even at the software level though, the same idea applies, where you can try closing and reopening the program, and then if that doesn't work, you can then try rebooting the whole computer. All right, so if you've already tried turning the thing off and on again, the next step in our process is to start Googling. If you come across a problem, whether it's an error message or just a weird bug, chances are you're not the first person to experience it. But again, pay attention because this is more of an art than a science, and what you should actually search will depend on the type of problem. The first type of problem is an error message, and while they can sometimes seem scary if you don't know what it means, believe it or not, getting an error message is sometimes the best case because it can often lead you directly to the solution. If there's an error message that only exists for one specific problem, you can find out what that exactly is and someone knows how to possibly solve it. So here's how to formulate a good Google search to find the solution to an error message of some kind. Look at the actual text of the error message and look for what looks like an error code and take note of it. There might not always be one, but basically an error code is there, assuming you're gonna go look up what it means. It's not like you have to know what every single error code means. No one does. Other times, if there is no actual error code, the rest of the error message itself might try and describe the problem. It doesn't matter if you have no idea what the error means, just copy it all down for reference. Now, if you're feeling lucky, the first thing to try is do a search for the name of the software and the error code, if there is one, or just the text of the error message. Sometimes you'll get lucky and right away you'll see results describing the exact issue and some possible solutions. Many other times though, the error message might not be very specific or might be a very general error message that can occur for any number of reasons. If that's the case, there's a third thing you'll need to add to your search, which I can best describe as conditions surrounding the error. For example, were you trying to do something in particular when the error occurred, such as when clicking a particular button or feature in the software? Then add that to the search, like when clicking X or when changing Z or whatever. So the whole search query would be name of the software, the error text, and then when doing thing. Also, alternatively, do you notice the error occurs when some other thing is happening? You could add a phrase like when Y feature is enabled or during loading of Z. Essentially, you just try a bunch of stuff, and when you notice the results start to get closer to what you're looking for and start to make a little bit more sense, further tweak the search to get closer and closer until you start to see things talking about your exact problem and possible solutions. To put these things together, let's do a couple examples. First, let's say you want to export a document from Microsoft Word as a PDF file, but it spits out some error when you try to do so. You could try searching something like MS Word error exporting PDF and try one where you paste some of the text of the error message. It doesn't matter what the error message is. For a very general example, let's say you're using a made-up program, Program Z, and you're trying to delete an item in the program, but it won't do it, and a red X appears at the bottom of the program. Clearly something is wrong, but it's not really an error message, it's just kind of like an X shows up, but you can still Google something like Program Z red X when deleting item. Now, obviously these examples won't cover every possible scenario, so you will need to do a bit of trial and error yourself to get good results, but I do have some general tips. Try to focus on keywords, not writing out a whole question like you're talking to a person. It will likely take several tries where you may have to rephrase the problem or use synonyms. In the earlier example, instead of using exporting PDF, try saving PDF, or maybe converting to PDF would be more appropriate depending on what you're doing. Also, keep track of the results and pages you come across that seem a bit helpful or insightful, even if it doesn't directly solve the issue. You can literally just drag the URL onto the desktop if you need to come back to it. I do this all the time when I'm searching a whole bunch of stuff. I have a million tabs open and I found a page that, okay, this isn't exactly what I'm looking for, but I definitely want to come back to this. It might be useful. Also, you should use the search results themselves as kind of a feedback on how to improve the search. For example, if you're getting search results that are all over the place, talking about all sorts of unrelated problems, you should be more specific by adding more keywords or changing them up. If the results are talking about problems that are sort of tangentially related, but not exactly what your problem is, try looking for clues or possibly related keywords that you can use to refine the search. There are plenty of times where I found a page that doesn't have a solution to the problem, but it did actually give me the name of the problem I didn't know how to name, which I can then use to search for sites specifically talking about that problem. Let me try to even more generally simplify this step into its bare basics. With your Google search, try to include keywords about the following: the name of the program or the device having the problem. Next, the unexpected behavior, such as error or freezing or all fonts turning into papyrus, whatever. Just try to describe it using a few keywords. And third, what action seems to trigger the problem, such as when saving, when changing a setting, clicking a certain button, etc. As a side note, I notice a lot of people get overwhelmed when seeing an error message they don't understand. Here's an important piece of advice. Even if you have no idea what the error means, just pretend you do and search it anyway. Don't assume just because you don't know what is causing the problem that means you can't fix it. There have been so many times where I fixed a problem and at the end of it, I said, well, I have no idea why that worked, but it did. And these tips don't just apply to software errors, the same principles apply to any device. For example, if your TV's sound mysteriously stops working, which actually did happen to me once, search brand X TV no sound. And also try a separate search being more specific with the model number. In this case, it's worth trying both with and without the specific model number because occasionally multiple models from the same brand have similar problems. And sometimes a solution that works for one model of a device may actually work on any other. You can also try being even more specific given the situation, like if you're using a soundbar or surround sound system, you can include that, such as brand X, model Z, no sound, external speakers, or soundbar. Try a variety of similar ideas. All right, now that you're a master of Google Foo, the third and final part of this video is the art of troubleshooting through trial and error, which is another invaluable skill. Sometimes a computer or tech problem will be an easy fix, other times not. You might do some searching and find several possible solutions to try. Other times, you just have to brute force it and figure it out yourself, but there is still a process to follow and make it easier. For the hardest, most vague and frustrating computer problems, this is my approach. Start out with zero assumptions and keep taking a step back, metaphorically, until you can identify where the problem starts and stops, and then you can narrow it down again. But what the heck do I mean by all that? Let me explain. Let's say, for example, my web browser seems really slow on my laptop, which is on Wi-Fi. Like, the pages are barely loading, if at all, and there's obviously a problem, but there's no error messages. It could be anything. First, I would mentally take a step back and try to figure out if this problem is isolated to just the browser, the computer, the whole network, or what. So I try a different web browser and the problem is still there. So, okay, it's at least happening to the whole computer. But again, we can't assume it's just that computer. So let's take another step back and see if my other computers are having the same problem. When I try my other laptop and phone, they also have the same problem. But when I try my desktop, it's completely fine. Now we're getting somewhere. So I want to think about what do all the problematic devices have in common and how are they different from the one that works? Well, my desktop is a wired connection, but the other things I was trying are all on Wi-Fi. So that really narrows it down to either the router or the Wi-Fi signal itself being the issue. So I'd first try just restarting the router and see if that fixes it. If it does, great. If not, assuming I didn't actually change any recent router settings or anything that could change the behavior of it, now I've still narrowed down the scope of the problem to the Wi-Fi connection itself. I mean, there's always the possibility that the router is broken, but I'm looking at the most likely scenario here. At this point, once you've narrowed it down as much as you can, I would just try whatever you can think of. Maybe it's a poor signal, so try moving the devices closer. Maybe it's interference, so try a different Wi-Fi channel, or wait until a different time of the day, maybe when not as many neighbors are using it. Or try using the 5 gigahertz band instead of the 2.4 gigahertz if your device supports it. Obviously, with super vague problems like this example, the final step of try whatever you can think of is going to heavily depend on your knowledge of the device. But don't worry if you can't figure it out exactly. Even if you get completely stumped and need to get support from a professional or someone who knows a little bit more, you will still have collected a ton of useful info to save time. Chances are, the tech person will probably try a bunch of stuff themselves. So now you can show them how you already narrowed it down. Now, that was an example with physical devices, but this process of stepping back to narrow it down can be applied at the software level too. For example, if a program is misbehaving, try opening up a different document and see if it keeps doing it. Maybe there is some setting that's applied to that document that's causing the issue. Essentially, if you can, you can think of it as trying to find the border of the problem, the edge of it, or anything that causes the problem to stop and start, which will point you towards the true cause. This is why a lot of times, if you're getting help from tech support, they may ask you to try a whole bunch of different stuff. Don't get frustrated if everything they suggest doesn't seem to do anything, because it may be greatly narrowing down the potential causes. So knowing these skills, you should hopefully be much more equipped to take on tech problems you never would have even attempted before. To summarize, remember these three major steps. First, turn it off and on again, seriously. Second, do a Google search describing the problem using the techniques I described. And third, if applicable, do some trial and error troubleshooting to narrow down where the problem exists. Keep in mind, in some cases, you might actually have to do step three to narrow down the problem enough to even start searching for it, so it's a little bit play by ear. But remember, you don't have to solve every single problem yourself, and don't worry if the next time you try this, you can't find a solution, because you might have just come across a really tough one that even the most knowledgeable techie couldn't solve. Just always at least try, because you will slowly build up knowledge and be able to solve even more and more problems as you go, just from experience. And hopefully, this video will be a game changer for some of you. So again, I want to thank Bitdefender for sponsoring this video. Be sure to visit the link in the description to check out Bitdefender Total Security, and also you can get that free 120-day trial, which is way longer than the usual 30-day trial everyone else gets. So be sure to check that link in the description. Now, if you guys want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is one where I talk about the things you must do when you get a new computer, and I'll put that link right here you can click on. So thanks so much for watching, guys. I'll see you in the next one.